Hello, welcome to my session about the year 2038 and what that means for UTEMP, WTEMP on 64-bit systems, especially on Linux as UMC. My name is Thorsten Kuckuck. I'm a synthesis engineer at SUSE. I'm leading the future technology team. I'm now with the company since over 24 years and looking back at over 25 years as open source developer in various areas, starting from GDC over NIST to Linux, PEM, and similar low-level user-end stuff. So, in the year 2038, on Unix, the 32-bit time T counter will overflow. If you never heard about this, then there is a really good Wikipedia article about this. But in short, the time T is a Unix counter starting at the January 1st, 1970 and increased with every second. And since it's a 32-bit signed variable on most 32-bit operating systems, it will overflow. And there is no universal solution in the C language. Any change to the definition of the time T data type would result in IPI breakage and code compatibility problems. Everybody who is currently working on changing a 32-bit Linux distribution to use a 64-bit time T knows about what I'm speaking here. It's also not possible really to change the signed integer to an unsigned one, because then you will lose the possibility to use or represent a date before 1970s, and the effort is similar to increasing it, because you also have to look at review all the source code using this variable, if it is okay how they use it. And increasing the size of time T to 64-bit in the existing system breaks the layout of structures and binary interfaces of functions. Again, the people currently working on 32-bit distributions switching to 64-bit time T now what I'm speaking about. So now 2038 is far, far away. And many people say that they will only support 64-bit architectures until then, which have already a 64-bit time T today. So why should they care? The answer is very simple. If you look at the header files of glibc, there is this define for compatibility between a 32-bit and 64-bit user land at the same kernel in the same system. And this defines the seconds as as a 32-bit int and not 64-bit or the system default. Which means even x86-64 with glibc on Linux is affected by this, and UTEMP will stop working in 2038. If you look at the affected API by UTEMP or WTEMP, you will find a long list of functions. And if we change the struct, we have an API breakage for all of them, except the one where you set the path to the file that stay compatible. So two functions out of the list will stay compatible, the rest has an ABI issue. And the affected files are run utemp, varlog, wtemp, varlog, lastlog, varlog, btemp, and maybe more who are using this struct. Now, of course, people think already since some years about how to solve it. So one idea, of course, is to use 64-bit time T everywhere. So adjust the struct in glibc to use a 64-bit time T in the struct utemp always on 32-bit and 64-bit systems. But this is a big headache, and it's in the same scope as currently the 32-bit Linux distributions going through who change the time T bit. It's a massive ABI breakage, since you cannot use symbol versioning or for structs or variables like
The problem is solved for the rest of the 32 to 64-bit time t transformation in Philips C. And the worst thing is there is now API for last lock, for example. You have a header file which defines a struct, no functions. So you would need to touch every single application to do it correct and work with it. Some people tried some proof of concept implementations, how to solve it on glibc level, but the glibc developers decided that they don't want to change the current UTEMP interface anymore, but they want to declare it as legacy and drop it in the feature. Which was so, that makes it pretty hard to come up with a solution on a low level. Additionally, the current UTEMP implementation or design, it's a design problem more or less, has a security problem. You can make a denial of service attack so that root cannot log in anymore. And you cannot solve it on glibc level, but you need a daemon for it. There is a bug report in the glibc tracker for this one who want to know more details about this. Another idea is there is free space in the UTEMP struct in glibc. The glibc developer reserved it for future enhancements. Now one idea is, can we not use that tool for and store the bigger value there? The first problem is glibc developers don't want to touch the UTEMP code anymore, but drop it. So at this moment already, it's clear that it will not happen, but there are also some big technical things, logical, and one of these problems is you have an application compiled with the old glibc, with the old struct UTEMP. It writes something to UTEMP, then you have an application which is using the new struct already. It reads the old entry, it does not find its data. So it will not really solve the problem, but will create a huge amount of problems because you have to change all applications at one time. You have to migrate all existing files and so on. So let's start with the easy files interfaces. We have lastlock. Lastlock stores the information when a user did log in the last time. It's storing the username, the port from TTY, and the time. And it will be found at the next login time as last log information. So as I said, there is no API for this. There is only a struct in a header file, which means every application has to implement it at their own, which also makes it pretty hard to convert it to something new because you have to touch every application. Additionally, we have the problem that only login and SSH have real support for lastlock. Else, there is a PEM lastlock module, which some distributors and some applications uses and configures, other not. So on my desktop at home, if I type last, it claims I did log in the last time last year, November, even if I did log in at that day, because somebody did not configure this display manager to use the last log PEM module. So it's also not trustworthy, so we need something completely new. Besides that, the current last log format has a problem. It's using sparse files, and with big UIDs, you get really large files. And at the moment where the file system or tools don't support files with big holes and don't support them, then you have a problem there. So we did implement lastlock too. It's replacing the lastlock implementation by using an SQLite database to store the data. It's implemented as PEM module, so you can configure it for every service where you want that it stores the last log information and that it follows it at the next login time. You have it in one place or code, so it's easy to update, to adjust, and to make sure that it is stored in a safe way, secure way, and always in the same way. We have a last log compatible last log 2 command where we created a compat symlink to. It can import the old lastlock file, and the future is that the Ute Linux maintainers want to merge lastlock 2 into Ute Linux, so as base and drop their own lastlock implementation. Then OpenSUSE, Tumbleweed, MicroS, and Alp, we use it already since several months. I got during all the time only one bug report because somebody was missing one last block. No, that was the vTemp. For this, we didn't got any bug reports, nobody noticed, it's just working. That was a good thing. Now WTemp. This file records all logins, logouts, boots, and shutdowns of a system in a historical way. There are, besides this, for entries, some other types which can be stored in the pre-systemd times, or maybe still today with some this for init daemons. The run level is stored there, but with systemd it does not exist, such concept. Then it stores the new time field. When I did the analysis during the year, who is using WTemp and why, I found one application which is reading this field, but I didn't find any application writing that. So address time, who is reading this field, will never find this in a VTemp file, in my opinion. And then there is all time where I only found several comments, what is it, who is using that, but I couldn't find any usage or definition of it. And the file is written more or less by all applications performing a login. So additional problem with the VTemp format as we have today is that there is no common rule what I should write into this file and at which time. So if you take VDM as example, the GNOME Display Manager, it creates always two WTemp entries for every login and logout, which is not a problem per se, but confusing. Then you have LikeDM, which is always using Dev Console as TTY. If you looked ever at the last source code, then you will see that last is using the login name and the TTY to find the matching logout and login entries. If you have now always the same TTY, and if users log in on several X displays or something similar, then with this, last is no longer able to match the login and logout records, and what last is displaying is wrong. It looks like that nobody really cares. I didn't find a bug report by it, but I could reproduce it that last is creating wrong output in these cases. And then some few terminal emulators write WTemp entries, others do not, so you have inconsistent data. Who is using that file? Last is the most prominent and often used application to read this file. And then there's LS logins, who is reading it, and some few others, but it's nearly rarely seldom that they access this file. So the solution here is also to use an SQLite database to store the data. One entry for login and logout. Since we have a database, we have a unique identifier, unique key for this entry, and can update the same entry. And we also wrote a PEM module to update, to have all code on one place, like with parm last log. And we have a last compatible command, which force then the information. And this is where I got in all the months we are using it now one bug report because one option of last was not implemented, but will follow the next days or weeks when I have time. So we integrated this already in OpenSUSE, as the PEM module is installed by default and configured by default. The applications and their configuration are adjusted. We have compat symlinks, and until now, as I said, there was one last option which some user found out is missing, else it looks like nobody noticed that we switched from VTemp to VTempDB already on OpenSUSE. Now the next step will be to disable VTemp support in all applications so that they don't write the file anymore. And now the most interesting one is a UTemp file. The UTemp file allows one to discover information about who is currently using the system. Again, there are no common rules what you should write into a UTemp file. And there is quite a lot of discussions between different developers of different tools, which ends in that, for example, Xterm and Console write UTemp entries, GNOME Terminal does not write these entries. And if you call uptime, you will see that uptime reports the users logged in on the system. But this is pretty meaningless because it doesn't tell you if you have 10 different users on the system or if there are only one user who is running 9 Xterms and maybe 200 GNOME terminals. So it doesn't tell you anything, this value. Also, the API has no error reporting. So if the UTemp functions don't return a new entry, then it does not mean there is none. It only means for you nothing you don't know. And the design issues, including the denial of service attack, also exist for this. No, exist for this, yes. You can, if you lock the UTemp file, you cannot log in anymore as root. And you can log in as normal user. Other problems is that usernames and devices are limited to 32 characters. If you look at the header files for the kernel or glibc, normally you have much bigger limits or no limit at all, which means if you store a username with more than, for example, 33 characters, it will be truncated. Same for device names. And which is also a little bit of a security risk is that the strings are not null terminated if they fit exactly in the variable, in the length of the variable. So if you read such a field, you have to look for the zero operator or that you read 32 characters. And if you, and I did read a lot of code to understand what applications do with the UTemp file and the data it contains, and a huge amount of them have in the one or other place a problem and will read behind the string because they did one of the checks in some cases wrong. So when I brought up this problem the first time, there was also a nice, in this regard, comment from Luca, one of the system developers on Linux Weekly News, and in Ford, we should stop limitating Linux because we should not look at the least common denominator Unix of 30 years ago, nobody remembers anymore, or looking at the commercial Unix 30 years ago, which has these limitations, we should remove them because Linux in reality don't have these limitations and we should, as I said, not limit by us by the past. To now find a solution how to replace UTemp, at first I analyzed who uses this file and informations. And one is the init daemon for process management, not with systemd, so we don't need that. Then we have a huge amount of applications writing UTemp entries for others, login, SSHD, XDM, GDM, SDDM, and all, you can continue this list. They all only write the entry, they never read it again. And then you have a few applications which read these files and use this data. It's most like W, who, uptime, wall, write, QEMU, Samba are also some tools which read the information and display them. So it's a limited number of applications. And then I group them in COM usages. Most often the application only use the UTemp file to count the number of logged in users. So every graphical terminal is a new user, e.g. an Xterm, but if the graphical interface is using, for example, GNOME terminal, which is not writing this file, then it's not a new user. It's already, as I said, they are confusing. It makes these numbers not really reliable, usable. Then you have tools who for information about logged in users. It's who, it's W, also Samba and QEMU are using it for this case. And then you have the wall messages sent to all logged in users. For example, if you shut down the system, and here it's locked, local logged in on console users, entry login, remote logged in users, SSH, and then you have the desktop users. So our GNOME user in the team tested it. He was using the GNOME terminal. He did not got a vol message. The KDE user got it, even if he had no terminals, because KDE creates a dummy UTEMP entry to get these messages. So in my opinion, this is something the desktop developers need to solve in a better way and not working with fake logins or expect that every desktop user has an XTERM or console open which is creating an UTEMP entry. So the solution for most of the problems is to create a new library with a daemon. Such implementation exists already, like UTEMPS, but this only solves the 32-bit time T problem and the security problems. It does not solve the API design problems. It does not solve, which is now error handling, the access of the struct, and you need to review all applications, independent if it is a 32-bit or 64-bit application, that they handle the 34-bit time T correct. And it's another daemon running on the system. But we have already daemons running on the system. Why should we create another one? And if we have to review and audit all code using the UTEP struct and functions, why not create something completely new without all the problems? Because writing the code new in a library or whatever is as expensive as reviewing and fixing all the code and searching outside there. And we have a daemon which is already running on systemd systems and which is collecting all this data already since several years, and that is systemd logind. It's used on all systemd-based Linux distributions. For the non-systemd one, there is, for example, elogind, which provides the same functionality. It's mature, and this should be hopefully secure. It has, as I said, it has all the data already collected via the PEM systemd PEM module. And there are several interfaces to it. You have logincTL, you have a dbus interface, and libsystemd. And with systemd since the last release, so 254, it also provides all functions you need to replace UTEMP. And this is looking then in this way, the mapping. So for the UT type field, only user process is supported, so we don't need that. UTPID, we have the SD7 get leader function, which is providing exactly this PID. For the TTY, we have the SD7 get TTY function. The UTID is a session ID. The UT user is the SD7 get username function provides it. The host is the SD7 get remote host function. UT exit and UT 7, we don't have replacements in the systemd, but I also haven't found any application using these two variables from the struct. And the login time we get with SD7 get start time. There is a little keyword in this because you can already start a systemd session before you log in. So this time is, in this case, not really correct, but it's the best we have in this case because it's really a question. If I start a session, which time counts? When I start the session or when then finally data the user access attached to the session. So it's also definition. And IP variable is then the UT host. It's identical in this case. If you know the UTEMP ABI function, it's in the end, you call set UTEND, you have a while loop about every entry, you pass a struct, you call end UTEND, and you have all information about the logged in users. So if you use libsystemd, the sdgetSession function is identical to the set UTEND function, more or less. You initialize the data structures and you get a list of active sessions, then you iterate over the sessions. You can fetch with the functions I mentioned on the previous slide all informations you need. And you can get much, much more information which UTEMP does not provide. So the gnulib developers already use this and query also additional information from LogInD and somehow incorporate them in their tools. For example, if you use who from coroutils with this, you will see additional output, which UTEMP normally does not provide. And in the end, you free what you got and you are done. If you look now at the COM usages from the beginning for what UTEMP is used, counting the number is really simple. You just call sdget7th with a null parameter and you get the number of logged in users. And since we have one instance logInD who controls what is a new session and what not, this number is now really reliable. You exactly know how many different users are logged in on your system. Informations about logged in users are found in who and we with this. Compatible versions of W and who are and similar tools already exist and most or all are already released. Other like Zamba and QEMU are currently work in progress. And for wall messages, works for local and remote console users because LogInD knows who logged in. It does not work currently for all desktop implementations. As I said, this is something the desktop people need to solve. Their display manager or Greeter has a TTY. It gets the messages. They only need a find to provide it to the logged in users who are not using a terminal, but maybe only a web browser or something similar. An analysis of the packages on the OpenSUSE Tumbleweed installation brought up a lot of packages which are affected and need to be changed. Everything which is dark green on this list is already able to or is already using LogInD instead UTEMP, and there are already released versions, which means on OpenSUSE, for Tumbleweed, for example, or MicroS, you just need to use them and they will use LogInD and no longer UTEMP in the background. So either the projects wrote their own patches on support for it, like the gnulib developers, that's why coroutils, Emacs, and other GNU applications will support it latest if they update to the current gnulib version, or they accepted our patches like PEM, PROC.PS, systemd, monitoring plugins. Fedder also created their own applications support. So the light green one are these applications which use UTEMP, but which we don't need to touch because it's enough to modify the PEM configuration and add PEM systemd to it. The blue ones are the one we don't need anymore. We don't need a helper application who writes to UTEMP because that's done via the PEM systemd module. The orange applications are the ones where we have patches and which are already part of OpenSUSE Tumbleweed, but which are not yet upstream. OpenSSH, for example, does not react at all to our mails and pull requests. Others, I didn't have the time yet to speak with upstream maintainers. And then, of course, we also have the maintainers who say, 2038, it's far, far away. I don't care. Go away. And the red ones are the ones where I'm asking if we really need it anymore. ACT, for example, saw the last patch 6 years ago, but they are convertible if somebody has time. And yeah. So then we have some applications writing UTEMP entries like ScreenScript, sudo extern. What should happen with them? So in my console opinion, and that is what most people also agreed with me in the discussions in the last months, is that XTERM and console and similar tools should not write UTEMP entries like GNOME Terminal. They should not fake entries so that they get the wall message, but that need to be solved correctly in the desktops. And then we have cases like screen-wise UTEMP entries, but it's not a login session, it's not a real session. Tmux does not write UTEMP entries on all Linux distributions, so it's a big mess there. And sudo is the same. Sudo writes sometimes UTEMP entry, sudo does never. discussions with the upstream systemd maintainer thought that they don't think that sudo foot create a new session, and that's why they block it in their code. I can partly understand it and agree to it, but yeah, that's something which is currently still in lesson. So what is the status of this in regard to OpenSUSE Tumbleweed and OpenSUSE MicroS? So we have systemd version 254 since last week. And with this, we also released CoreOtils, OtiLinux, ProcPS, and many packages more who are now using LogInD. So since 1 week, OpenSUSE Tumbleweed and MicroS are using LogInD and no longer on UTEMP for the most applications. And I haven't seen any comment. I announced it on the Tumbleweed mailing list. No reaction, no bug reports. So it seems like nobody is really noticing it, that the informations are now coming from another data source, because the output is the same. So what's missing is systemd is using internal still UTEMP for the wall messages. I fixed that 2 weeks ago. So with systemd 255, we can really build a systemd without UTEMP support at all. QEMU and Zamba, they need to be converted. Zamba, I have patches. I tested them. They are working. I only need to contact upstream. QEMU should be even easier than Zamba. And then I hope that we, in some months, can disable writing UTEMP entries at all and yeah, have a system which is in regard to UTEMP, WTEMP, and lastlog year 2038 clean. There are some references. I wrote a blog with a lot of background information and feedback from others. There is a Git repository for me where I collect some files which lists up all projects and what is done and what still open to need to do. A document which describes how to convert from UTEMP to LogInD. I have also a directory with patches for packages which are still work in progress or where I didn't have the time to submit them upstream. And there is a repository with binary RPMs for Tumbleweed with all the RPMs with these patches. But since meanwhile everything is in Tumbleweed, that's not needed anymore. So are there no questions? So I don't see anything in the publicum because it's so dark. Okay, thank you. Are there any questions about this? Any concerns? Other ideas? Oh, there's one question. I don't know if I have a micro or...
I'll just shout.
Okay. So I think I come here and then I repeat it. It's my besser. So.
Have you tried adjusting the clock forwards on your computer to testing if things, everything is now actually working beyond 2038?
That is, so the question was if we already tried it with a computer running in year 2040 or something similar. Currently, we have test cases which emulate this by calling all this code with a faked time. We have not installed a real system because this is only about UTEMP, VTEMP, and lastlog. And it is not about all the other stuff which is still using a 32-bit time T, which means currently, no, so until 1 or 2 months ago, even our installer was not able to install on such a system. So these are other teams, they are working on it. I know Debian is working on replacing, changing, or switching from a 32-bit time T to a 64-bit time T on their 32-bit distribution. They are also work in progress, and that's why I got so much help from the GNU developers, because the Debian people complained to the GNU developers, and then they suddenly woke up and wrote all the code overnight. So it's currently, everybody is doing similar steps, but we don't have a full thing which could work together. But this already solves some problems like the security issues, no error reporting and similar things. More questions? Yes.
The old last command had an argument reboot. You could do last reboot and get a list of reboots in kernel versions.
That is a single missing feature I mentioned, which is work in progress. Reinhard Max, I think you know him, promised me to implement it, but he didn't found the time for it yet. I think I have to look at it myself if I'm back from all the conference in time now, traveling. But it's on the to-do list. The question was, the alt last command has an argument that you could list the users, you could specify a username, and then you could get all log entries for this user, and this is what I mentioned is missing, but will come. Yes?
Aren't you working to a link on this problem since we have 15 more years until?
Because I don't have 15 more years, I have a few months for this. The normal desktop lifetime Linux operating system is about 4 years. So they have plenty of time to solve it. But if you look at the enterprise server market or embedded market or edge market, then the Linux distributors, the big one, create now the distributions which have a longer lifetime and will still be available and running in 2038 and later. And this is a change you don't want to do with a maintenance update, especially as we have, at least Azusa, I think the others have the same, big customers who want a distribution where we guarantee that without update and modification, it still runs after 2038. So that means, yes, in some use cases, there is plenty of time. In other use cases, we have no time anymore. That's why I started with it at all, because we have the time prefer, we see them. So, more questions? Yes?
Regarding free-to-bit applications and use cases in multi-lib, are there any plans for those kinds of applications?
I didn't understand. Regarding what?
So, that is above 2048, a lot of them will crash even if they use a time T64.
So the question was about BI systems having applications, 64-bit and 32-bit applications running on the same system, how it will work or not for 32-bit applications. So the answer is binaries as of today, who are 64-bit x86-64 or 32-bit x86-64, will stop working 2038. There is no way to get them running there. So this, oh, I see it's, okay, screen server, jump in. So you have to adjust these applications. And if you use login D, so all what I told about 64-bit is also true and will work with 32-bit. All the interfaces of libsystemd, of vtemdb, of lastlog2, all of them are using int64. So the and not in seconds, but I think it's micro, and I think whatever systemd is using there, I don't remember exactly, I have to look up. So we are safe in this regard with this on both architectures. And of course, since they all use then an int64 type, they're also compatible to each other. Yes?
On the previous slide, you mentioned compiling the glibc with all the support for UTMP. Do you think it's feasible to make a scanner that via static code analysis will check if there are applications that would fail with this disabled in glibc?
So the question was, if we make disable the code in glibc, will check tools create a warning, will that fail or not? So today, MuselibC, for example, has the functions and is returning enosis, no data. With libc developers plan the same. How this affects static code analyzers, if they can detect it, I don't know. I'm not in that business. I spoke with our compiler people, and they said there are some ways to detect it, but there are so many options with casting and accessing the virus and so on. They say, we tried it and we got more false positives than real positives. So yes, I think that is a nice research topic to write a static code analyzer who is going over the source code and tells you where you have a problem with 32-bit time t in the year 2038. I don't know if somebody is working already on that. I haven't got any feedback about this. More questions? Okay, then I want to thank you that at least a few people tried to fill up this big room, and thank you for listening.